increase enrollment and persistence. We talk, Tuskegee University is great with its retention. You're excellent. You can look at first and second year rates, you can look at second and third year rates. But I'll be spending a lot of time learning and understanding what we're doing with 21st century recruitment, but also 21st century persistence. I talked in point two about innovative academic programming. Everyone knows that we are and will continue to be a STEM-centered leading university throughout all of higher education. This is who we are, this is part of our DNA. However, when one talks about persisting, there are some occasions where students find that, you know, my gifts, my skill sets, my talents may not lend themselves towards STEM. They may lend themselves to arts and letters. I intend to strengthen STEM by putting the A in STEM, putting some steam in STEM, by making sure that this institution is also an institution that focuses on arts and letters as well as STEM. And I want to explain this to my STEM colleagues, because I don't want STEM colleagues, oh, see, I knew this English guy's gonna change. We're not gonna be STEM, trust me.
Administrators, faculty, and staff who are within various units, and they will be able to help. Booker T. Washington did at 25. That will never be repeated in history. But what I am grateful to do is to empower people, to expect people, regardless of race, gender, color, and religion, to produce outcomes. Simple as that. That's how I'm going to be judged. I'm a nice guy. I have a great family. I'm a pretty smart guy. But I want to be evaluated on outcomes and producing. And thus, I will need people to help me produce. If you can help me produce faculty, staff, and students, then we're going to have this indeed preeminent 21st century institution. And finally, the fifth hallmark of an outcomes-oriented academic organization is fostering a culture of advancement and development with a diverse portfolio of fundraising. There's much here to be discussed when we talk about fundraising. We hear the notion and the concept of fundraising, you know, fundraising. Well, if really you are around fundraising, you realize that fundraising occurs when there is a cause to be made, a case to be made as to why one will give you money. Here's the thing, here's a little secret. No one will simply give me money because I asked for it. They want to know how it be used. It's not going to be used to pay for bills that you can pay for yourself. They want to know, are you currently paying your bills? How many of you got friends and family members? I do too. And they want to borrow money. I may have a little money, but why would I give it to you just to simply waste that money? I mean, I have friends and they're like, let me borrow $5. But I've seen you spend your $5 doing it this way. No, I will keep my $5, pass it to my sons, and ensure this is the spirit of philanthropy. Philanthropy is stewardship. I steward over my monies. I give to worthwhile causes. And then here's how this works. They give to an initiative, a case that they support, that's strong and thriving and outcomes oriented. And guess what? The monies that the university was using in that direction can now be redistributed into other directions that are also efficiently managed. This is the spirit of philanthropy. And guess what? It's not a one-man show. It's a university-wide show. So when I talk about a diverse portfolio of development, I'm not just simply talking about research federal government dollars. That's a very important space. We have over $30 million a year coming into this institution under the great work of the Vice President of Research and many of the faculty members here. I know of what we're gaining and I know the sources, but we talk about a diverse portfolio. We mean private foundations, major donors, individuals. There may be an individual who, I would love to support a brand new theater program. Do I have theater faculty? Do you have a venue that will support that? Do you have enough students there? We have to be very imaginative about philanthropy. And make no mistake, we're going to still receive and pursue and push STEM-generated funding from the federal government. But in order to survive in the 21st century, as is everyone, you must have a diverse portfolio where you're not completely dependent in such a way that the institution now becomes just an institution that does one thing. We want to do multiple things because we want to appeal to multiple constituencies, multiple foundations, multiple donors, all types of donors. And so I will be spending a lot of time with our executive council, with our dean's council, the university council. You'll know that these are three new constructions that I will talk in the coming weeks about, where everyone in the institution will begin to work with me in understanding that our institution, our administrators, our faculty members, our staff members need to be both internal managers but also external election. I don't have a problem with that. You produce, I don't have any problems. But there will be other areas where we have to establish what these outcomes are. And guess what? We're in it together. This is not an administration where you're going to come out of the blue and I come and talk to you and it's like, oh, you're out of here. No, we're going to work together to discover what are appropriate outcomes for your union. Outcomes that will push us into the 21st century. Outcomes that will help us to fulfill a 10-year plan. Outcomes that will help us to be the kind of institution that individuals want to give to. And of course, there won't be outcomes like my sons will do when I suggest, you know, if I just get 2 B's and 1 A and 3 A, is that enough? No, we're going to push ourselves. Outcomes essentially tell us, how do we know when we get there? How are we measuring our progress there? That's all outcomes are. And so Dr. Griffin and the Institutional Research and Effectiveness Office will be joined at my hip in helping me, along with a number of different units, and in my one-on-one meetings with various unit leads to begin this. And to this point, fostering a culture of advancement and development, a diverse portfolio of fundraising. To this end directly, pertaining to advancement and development, my wife and I, and my sons, we are pleased to announce a gift to the university of a $100,000 endowment at $20,000 in hand.
Yeah.
disciplinary. It's a prime opportunity for all of our non-STEM fields here. Colleagues at Drexel University have a program, Science and Technology Society, and the main thing they're looking for are arts and humanities and letters professors who can help translate what our colleagues in the STEM are doing to the wider population. I'm an English guy. I'm an arts and humanities guy. That's my discipline. I wrote a couple of books on Du Bois. I know the chair didn't mention that. I know people are going to say, I don't know the Du Bois scholar. Get to become the president. Okay, Du Bois and Booker T. Washington. And maybe if someone sets up a lecture, I can give you a full exegesis on how is it that a man can be and possess a Washingtonian philosophy and yet write two books on W.E. Du Bois. Again, innovative. Not in a box. Oh, you care, like Du Bois and Washington. But they both joint published their essays in a 1907 book together. W.E. Du Bois taught here very briefly. Booker T. Washington esteemed Du Bois, and W.E. Du Bois esteemed Booker T. Washington. There's a lot that we can talk about. But again, when we talk about words and needs, I'm not just telling you what to do and I'm backing away. I'm going to be in there talking with you about ways to do it and to do it myself. We talk about efficient resource management. Dr. Johnson, why are we doing this? Here are the reasons why. Here are the outcomes produced. Here are the outcomes not produced. In consultation with the board, in consultation with the executive council, here is the reason why we can or cannot do this. Here's what's coming in. Here's what's going out. Now, of course, I won't be able to share the details of every single thing, but I will with university council, your staff senate president, faculty senate president, SGA president, all of which I'll meet with regularly, either bi-weekly or every week. Those meetings are already scheduled. People will be informed because I need an educated campus constituency, an educated alumni constituency. I need an educated faculty, staff, and student body in terms of how do you manage and run a 21st century organization. It's not, I have an idea, let's spend $1 million on it. We cannot do that. It's not, well, we should do this, but based on what data? Do you know how much it costs? Yeah, these are the kinds of questions I will ask and put back to you. And I'll visit alumni chapters, I'll visit students. I'm going to have listening meetings of students and faculty groups. Faculty Senate President will help organize the listening meetings, faculty members, not just the chairs and the deans, the faculty. In groups, in settings throughout the year, listening meetings where I will come and allow you to talk. This will not be a monarchy. This is not an institution that will stifle the best ideas, the best performance. I want the best to rise to the top. I want the best ideas. We talk about another great figure of this institution, George Washington Carver, and you hear this term, organic, and we blow past this term because we think of organic foods and it's of the earth, and this, but what it really means is all the particles of the environment, the soil, the sun, the water, the rain, all of it plays a role in the production of the eventual tree and the eventual fruit that comes from it. Every single person here must play a role. It's not Dr. Johnson's success and failure. You know what? If I succeed, it's because of you. If I do not succeed, it's because of you. It works both ways. If I succeed, it's me. All the elements of the soil and the rain and the sun came together and we got it done. And if I didn't, it didn't. And I'm a part of that as the chief executive officer. So when I talk about words and needs, that's very important. And then finally, I think some of you are noting your time. The chair is very excellent time. The question of was
does he have enough to say? Oh, do I? And much more is it. I am so ready for Monday. I'm so ready for next year, and the year after, and the year after, and the year after.
My administrative philosophy will be transparent,
consistent, collaborative, and particularly communicative to the entire community, including all of his friends and supporters. What I say broadly here, I may go in more detail with executive council. What I say in executive council might be in less detail with certain groups of students if I'm in passing at a football game, but there will be consistency. There will be communication, both in writing and in speech. I generally prefer to write so that I'm not at all misquoted. Even as I speak today, the media who is currently here is in possession of my remarks. The board of trustees are in possession of my remarks. The alumni should be in possession of my remarks at this moment. So, I would like to ask you in closing to do two things. I'm asking Tuskegee University, faculty, Tuskegee University, staff, Tuskegee University, students, Tuskegee University, alumni, Tuskegee University, supporters, friends, future students, I'm asking you to do two things. I'm asking you to, number one, trust the Tuskegee tradition. Number two, I'm asking you to trust the Tuskegee trajectory. Thank you.